Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Sir.
Struggle with paying mortgages, which will soon return.
Mr. Speaker, Honourable Prime Minister,
they cannot pay the bill.
Honourable Leader of Opposition,
our people struggle with paying mortgages.
Honourable members of this other house,
soon return.
Good day and a very good afternoon.
And principal payments needing to be.
I rise in this other house to lend my support to the motion by the Honourable Prime Minister to thank His Excellency the President for his most gracious speech. Mr. Speaker, sir, let me first acknowledge the hopeful statement made by His Excellency the President as he reminded all Fijians that we are still in the midst of global COVID-19 crisis and while we continue to battle climate crisis. Nevertheless, we have proved not only to ourselves but also to the rest of the world the spirit of resilience that is in the core of every feature. This same resilience has allowed us to build back stronger from natural disasters and help us to celebrate and mark our 50th year of independence as a COVID-19 contained country. And I personally believe that because of our resilience, the best is yet to come for Fiji. Secondly, I echo these sentiments for the Honourable Minister Seri Ratu in acknowledging the visionary leadership of the Bainimarama government that has revealed the mask potential for Fiji through our 5-year and 20-year national development plan. Mr. Speaker, sir, as Fiji settles into the 2020 and 2021 tropical cyclone season, achievements of our national development plan and its planned initiatives are threatened by the possible onset of natural disasters, some of which can be terrible in nature, that unfortunately we have become accustomed to. Mr. Speaker, sir, this other House has heard how through good governance, the Bainimarama government has developed legislation, policies, and plans to safeguard our land-one developments. Fiji has even made notable achievements on the world stage of it. However, we will not rest on our achievement. We will continue with our efforts to steward all people and our environment for a better future. Mr. Speaker, sir, I concur with His Excellency the President in applauding frontline responders for COVID-19. They have showed their loyalty and care for fellow Fijians in serving diligently and passionately at the various isolation facilities to ensure that COVID-19 is contained. The containment of this deadly disease is indeed a test of the effectiveness of the COVID-19 safe restrictions and a protocol carefully designed by the government. Mr. Speaker, sir, the government has put in place relevant interventions aimed at maintaining our current COVID-contained status and at the same time drive economic recovery and build communities that are resilient to disasters and have methods of climate change, adaptation and mitigation. Mr. Speaker, sir, please allow me to share some of these ongoing risk-informed developments, in particular those that have taken place in the rural communities from the Friendly North Division and Eastern Division, respectively. Mr. Speaker, sir, in addition to providing an enabling environment, the Ministry will continue to empower our rural population to contribute to the socio-economic development of Fiji. In my address today, I will be elaborating on government initiatives in the Northern Division and Eastern Divisions. In the Northern Division alone, government has invested since 2016 a total of 1.4 million in self-help projects, while the Eastern Division recorded 0.5 million. As mentioned by the Honourable Minister Seri Ratu this morning, the self-help scheme has moved from solely focusing on social projects to livelihoods approach to address root causes of poverty. This is implemented through the provision of income generating opportunities. Mr. Speaker, sir, through the current trend we are seeing with the urban to rural migration of skilled workers, the self-help grants will ensure that skills do not go to waste in the rural areas, but are strengthened for active socio-economic contribution to the communities and the country. We acknowledge that the COVID-19 also brings opportunities to rethink our systems and make them more resilient to future shocks. Mr. Speaker, sir, I must note that it is obvious that such programs also support our commitments to various sustainable development goals. The construction of community access road is another fine example of the ministry's rural empowerment programs. While our remote rural areas make available the market for primary products that feed our primary and secondary industries, the construction of such roads will assist with making this market accessible. In the Northern Division, government has invested 0.7 million over a 4-year period with a total of 29 projects implemented. For the Eastern Division, a total of 0.3 million has been invested in this program. Mr. Speaker, sir, in facilitating the expansion of the services to remote and rural areas, the government has invested 0.5 million in the establishment of a government station on the island of Koro. This government station will serve a population of 3,000, and by bringing government service closer to the people, it also reduces the risk that the people of Koro had to face when crossing overland by sea to access government services. Mr. Speaker, just last month, an additional government station was opened in Kavala on the island of Kandabu to complement the existing station in Wulsia. Government has invested 1.2 million for this project to ensure that the 40 kilometers of the island, Ono, Nakasaleka, and Nadeva, can eliminate the risk and cost of traveling to Wulsia by sea to access government services. In addition to this, an administration station is currently being constructed in Wainikoro, Maduata, and additional residential quarters in Kumulau, worth 1 million and 0.5 million respectively. Next year, the government is proposing the establishment of government office in the Lau Group. Initial works commenced for the construction of a station in Bonwambalau. There have also been discussions to consider one for the Asas Moala or Central Lau Group of islands. These services contribute to the government efforts in bringing the development gap that is existent in the Eastern Division, particularly in the Lau Group. And through the establishment of this government office, the risk and cost of traveling to access government service is eliminated. Mr. Speaker, sir, let me emphasize that extending the reach to our community will certainly establish the enabling environment to the potential of our rural and maritime islands as we reset the rural community for Fiji economic recovery from the impacts of COVID-19. Mr. Speaker, sir, the Ministry, through the Integrated Rural Development Framework, collaborates with other agencies in the identification, tracing, and long-term development issues for our rural and maritime communities. In addition, our advisory council provides development management link between the communities and the government. And this is done through promoting, facilitating, and implementing government policies within their communities. The tech meetings in the Northern Division were conducted last month, and the councillors were also briefed on new terms of reference to which they are required to work on. The Eastern Division tech was conducted yesterday. The Ministry is doing its best to improve in level of preparedness for disaster, and this is one of the reasons for convening that meetings last month and this month, so that it drives the message of preparedness continuously to our communities. Mr. Speaker, sir, The ministry works with government agencies to implement adaptation measures in response to climate change, as well as programs for mitigation and adaptation. Mr. Speaker, sir, I would like to acknowledge the Minister for Waterways and Environment for the various incentives implemented in our coastal areas and riverbanks, such as the planting of mangroves and vetiver grass and construction of seawalls. These include projects such as nature-based eco-seawall in Raviravi village, Madhuata, the new hybrid seawall at Viro village, Ovalau, and the nature-based seawall in Namukarna village, in Ram, to name a few. Planting of vetiver grass in these areas were also carried out. Mr. Speaker, sir, the Ministry has been involved in reef-to-reef activities. Earlier this year, the Ministry signed a memorandum of agreement with the Ministry of Waterways and Environment. The purpose of the MOA is to document a framework of cooperation between the ministries to effectively and effectively implement a project titled Implementing a Reef-to-Reef Approach to Preserve Ecosystem Services, Reduce Carbon, Improve Climate Resilience, and Sustain Livelihoods in Fiji. This project is funded by the Global Environment Facility with funds implemented through the United Nations Development Programme, UNDP, with activities executed in Fiji through the Ministry of Waterways and Environment. The project under the MOA will be implemented for 6 water catchments of Bunibia, Tunuloa, Lambasa in the Northern Division, Tabua Enba in the Western Division, Rewa and Waingina catchment in the Central Division. In addition, Mr. Speaker, sir, the Ministry is represented in the National Red Plus Steering Committee, which is led by the Ministry of Forest. This is to ensure that we also participate in the decision-making process for initiatives that impact on the environment of the climate action, and to assist in the dissemination of information to our rural people. Mr. Speaker, sir, through the push from global and regional disaster risk reduction agendas, Fiji has all recognized the need for proactive approach to disasters and not a reactive approach. Government endorsed in 2019 the National Disaster Risk Reduction, DRR, policy, outlining 122 action items that will mainstream disaster risk reduction into all aspects of development. However, government has already been investing in disaster risk reduction, or DRR, activities that will safeguard our vulnerable rural and maritime communities. Mr. Speaker, sir, between 2014 and 2018, a total of 10 DRR projects were implemented in the Northern Division and 1 in the Eastern Division. These DRR projects include the construction of seawalls, the construction and retrofitting of evacuation centers, riverbank protection, and relocation of climate displaced communities. A total of $2.3 million has been invested by government to safeguard our vulnerable rural and maritime communities by building their resilience to the impacts of natural disasters. Mr. Speaker, sir, another critical service that government provides is the coordination of disaster risk management activities. The establishment of the District Administration Office in these remote areas will act as the coordination hub to deliver timely disaster relief to each suffering. Mr. Speaker, sir, government officials are currently being trained on how to work on a team in the Emergency Operations Center. Please allow me to thank the Government of Australia, Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, whose funding support through the Australian Humanitarian Partnership has allowed these trainings to take place. This training will equip government officers with the right skills and knowledge to work as a team inside an emergency operation center to deliver a timely response to each suffering of disaster-affected communities. The target area of this training has been the Northern Division, with trainings conducted in Tabeuni and two more trainings be conducted in Lambasa and Sausau respectively. The ministry has also established a smart partnership with the non-government organization through the Fiji cluster system to ensure that disaster ready activities also reach our rural and maritime communities. One such activity is the delivery of community-based disaster risk management trainings. Through this training, our communities are empowered with the knowledge and skill which they can add to their existing traditional coping mechanism to respond and bounce back from the impacts of disaster. For this financial year, a total of 20 communities have been trained in the northern and eastern divisions. Mr. Speaker, sir, this community-based disaster risk management training will also empower the communities to form and establish their community disaster management committee, who will then develop a community disaster plan. This CDP is then tested through a model exercise where the communities are given validate the plan. This plan is, of course, aligned to our existing disaster risk management. While government, through the ministry, coordinates disaster response activities, we also empower our communities with skills to build their resilience to natural disasters. Mr. Speaker, sir, in looking to the future, the overwhelming concerns are the climate crisis with the impending impacts of terrible natural disasters. This coupled with the global COVID-19 crisis will only test our resolve. But come what may, the government through the ministry will continue to provide the enabling environment to reset the rural community, the rural economy, and build our people's resilience to disasters. Mr. Speaker, sir, before I conclude, we all know that we are in the cyclone season. We have been experiencing heavy rain this week. I urge the members of this other house to encourage our families and our communities to take heed of their roots. Notices of weather conditions and take precautionary measures accordingly. Let's all be responsible and embrace disaster preparedness and readiness to be role models for the people that we serve. Mr. Speaker, sir, thank you for the opportunity to respond to this excellency, the President's speech, and I wish the members of this House Merry Christmas and a successful and prosperous New Year. Now I leave, sir.